Jai Hind children, we are here again to just continue the second chapter, that is A-Layer anomalous field. So far we have studied about the classification of matter based on the chemical composition. Now we have studied about mixes, and we know when two or more pure substances are mixed together, then the matter is called mixer. Many a times in our life, we need pure substances. We don't need any of the substance mixed with it, as it could be for medicine, for lab work. We need pure substances. Then we should know how can we separate the components of a mixer, how can we obtain the desired component from our mixer. Mostly in nature, the substances which we obtain, the matter which we obtain from the nature, that is mostly impure. So let us study about some techniques of separation. And the technique of separation of a mixer depends on the properties of the component present in that mixer. So there may be a number of methods used. You have already studied about some methods in class. The lower classes you have studied about filtration. If you have to separate insoluble impurity from a liquid, then using a filter we can separate the insoluble solid as a residue, that is filtration. Then you have studied about sieving, where you have to different solids which are having the different particle size. So by selecting an appropriate sieve, you can separate the two components that are sieve. Then hand picking, if the number of that undesired component is less and that is big enough to be seen with the naked eye, so we can pick that out with the help of with the hand also. Then you have studied that magnet, using a magnet if they are magnetic and non-magnetic components. So these are the few techniques which you have already studied. Binomial ones you have studied. Now there are some more techniques which we will be studying in detail in class 9. Evaporation, centrifugation, then decantation, centrifugation, this is sedimentation and decantation using a separating funnel, sublimation, centrifugation, chromatography, distillation and fraction distillation. We will also study about crystallization. Let us take these techniques one by one, and we will be discussing what is the principle involved and what type of mixers can be separated. What all components are there, what type of components in a mixer can be separated by that particular technique, and we will be studying about the application of that technique also in our life. So let us start first with evaporation. Evaporation, as you have already studied about evaporation, when liquid is heated, it changes into vapor at all temperature below the boiling point, then the technique is called evaporation. Actually, if you are given, as I said, ink, ink is a mixer of dye and water. So, if you have ink, and that I said is the mixer of dye and water. In this mixer, we see that there is one component which actually changes into vapor on heating. We call such a component the volatile component. And the other component easily does not change into vapor. So that is non-volatile component. So if a mixer consists of a volatile and a non-volatile component, and we want to obtain only the non-volatile component, then what can we do? We can just simply remove this volatile component by heating, or we can say that simply by carrying out evaporation, we can obtain non-volatile components. So for this we will be taking the mixer in a beaker, or if you want you can heat it indirectly also over a beaker, and then using the Bunsen burner you will heat the mixer. Then the non-volatile component in this case is dye will be left in the chine dish, where is water will go into atmosphere as water vapor. So this technique we call evaporation, and as I said, this evaporation can be used for the mixer which has components volatile and non-volatile. In day-to-day life, it is used for obtaining salts from the salt solution. As I said, dye, it's where whether it's, this mixer is a solution, suspension or a colloid. And it is having two components, one is volatile out of that. So the non-volatile component can always be obtained from such a mixer by the process of evaporation. Another technique which we studied is centrifugation. We have already studied suspension, the component can be separated with the help of filtration. Solution, we will study it in later. The method called distillation can be used to separate the component of a solution. So if you are given a colloid, The method which we will be using for separation is centrifugation. Colloid is having the particles which have different densities. So what is done in case of centrifugation? The mixer is rotated at a very high speed. When the mixer is rotated at very high speed, the lighter component floats over the denser. So lighter one comes to the top, whereas the heavier one goes to the bottom. So this way the component gets separated. And the centrifugation is, as I said, it is used for separation of the component of a colloid. And in day-to-day life, it is being applied. It is being used in dairies or in homes to separate butter from cream. Right, washing machine also, the dryer works on the same principle, that the heavy water goes down when the wet clothes are heated at high speed and then only dry clothes are left. Then in pathological labs, the component of blood and the desired component in blood or and urea, they can be separated by centrifugation. Next is decantation using the separating machine. If you are given a mixer of immiscible liquid, right? Immiscible liquids means the liquids which do not separate at all. So we use a special apparatus which we call separating panel. Separating panel is glass separators, it's funnel shaped glass separators. So the immiscible liquid, let it be mixer of oil and water. So that mixer is taken in the separating panel. Here you can see it has a stopper that controls this opening. So we fill the mixer in the separating funnel. We keep it undisturbed for some time, right? So when it is kept undisturbed for some time, as the liquids are immiscible, they separate into layers. The heavier one will go to the bottom, whereas the lighter one will float over it. So in case of oil and water, oil will float over water. Now we just, without disturbing, so this is sedimentation where we have allowed the mixture to settle down, the heavy impurities, heavy liquid to settle down without disturbing. Now without disturbing the upper liquid, we slowly open this stopper and we just flow the denser liquid into a beaker. This is decantation. So the heavier liquid gets collected in the beaker, where the lighter liquid remains in the separating panel. So immiscible liquids can easily be separated by using separating panel. So we can any mixer of immiscible liquid, any oil mixed with water, or maybe a mercury mixed with water, that can easily be separated by separating panels using the technique sedimentation and decantation. So next is, suppose you are given a mixer where, let it be salt and ammonium chloride. Here, whenever we are selecting a technique, we always look at the properties of the two components. And we select that property as the basis, which is shown by one component, is not shown by the other component. Here, salt and ammonium chloride, if we just study the properties, we find that ammonium chloride directly changes into vapor on heating. This process we call sublimation, whereas salt does not change into vapor. So easily we can separate ammonium chloride and salt by sublimation. For this we need the apparatus. Actually, ammonium chloride will change into vapor on heating. So suppose if I have taken the mixer of ammonium chloride and salt. Okay, this is the mixer and I place it over the tripod stand over which I have placed the wire gauze. And if I heat it, what will happen? Ammonium chloride will change into vapor and it will go into air. So it will be lost, but we want both the components. So if I want to collect the sublimable component also, so I just make an arrangement. I take the funnel, I invert it over the this china dish, and then this mouth also, it just, there is the possibility that vapor may escape. That also we close with the help of a cotton plug. Here I am closing it with the help of the filter paper. Right? We ensure the paper do not escape. Right? And then we heat. Now what will happen? Ammonium chloride will change into vapor. sand will condense again directly. The vapor will condense to solid. So ammonium chloride will be obtained in the inner side of the funnel, whereas salt will be left in the chamber. So this way, sublimation process can be used for any mixture of the solids which has one component which sublimes on heating and the other component which does not sublime on heating. And we all know the examples of solids which sublime on heating. It could be aluminium, it could be naphthalene, it could be anthracene, dry ice, ammonium chloride. So these are some solids which sublime on heating. So if they are any of these has mixed with any other solid which does not sublime, we can always use sublimation. Next principle next technique which can be used for the separation is chromatography. This is a very important technique and just try to understand. As I said, chromatography, actually this technique it is first used to separate the colors. So chroma word in Greek is used for color. So that's why this technique was called chromatography. Now chromatography is a technique which can be used to separate a mixture of a solid, a number of solids which are soluble in a common solvent. Like just take an example. As I discussed with you, ink is a mixture of dye in water. But dye itself is not a single substance. It is again a mixture of many colors. Right? If I want to obtain colors from dye, I'll be using method which I call chromatography. For this, we use this is actually paper chromatography. Here we use a special paper which we call chromatography paper. Here you just see, this is chromatography paper. And now I just take this chromatography paper. Actually, as I said, these colors. Dye is made up of, black dye is made up of a number of colors, and these solids should be soluble in a common solvent. Here I know all the colors of black dye, they are soluble in water. So I am using water as a solvent to separate the different colors of black dye. So for this I take chromatography paper, I draw a line 3 cm above the margin, the lower margin. Then I put a drop of black dye here. I let it dry for few minutes. So when I allow it to dry for some time, then water will evaporate and only dye will be left. So now I have dye on the chromatography paper and now I want to separate its color. So what do I do? I take a beaker, I take native water in it, I take a precaution, keep water. The quantity of water should be such that when I put this chromatography in this, its lower end will be dipped in water. Actually, this spot of dye should not be dipped in water. Now you know, when I place it in water, chromatography paper has very good water absorption capacity, so water rises. And when this water reaches the dye, now it will dissolve the color of dye also. Now you can see the water has reached the spot and it has dissolved the colors, and these colors have also started rising. I did it earlier and I'll have to leave it for some time and I'll be showing you the result. One of the classes I did it and I got it in this way. Now actually what happens, though all the colors, these all colors which are mixed in a dye, they all are soluble in water, but their solubility in water is not same. Some have more solubility than the other. So the component which has more solubility, that moves faster along with water on this paper and reaches a greater height. And the component which is less soluble, that will be moving slowly and will just simply will be reaching to lower height. So this way, different colors of the dye, based on the solubility in the solvent, they get separated at the different heights. As in this case, I can see the blue color is at the top. So the blue color in that black dye had the maximum solubility, had the highest solubility, so it just reaches the greatest height. Whereas I can see that red color is at the bottom, so it is soluble, but its solubility is less, so it's near the bottom. And in between, I can see some yellow color also. So this way, using chromatography, different colors of the dye can be separated, right? So this is a technique which we can use to separate colors from dye. It can also be used to separate colors from the natural pigments. Then it is also used to separate drugs from blood. So it has got a number of application. The type of mixers, it could be the mixer which is containing a number of solid, but all those solids should be soluble in a common solvent. So using that common solvent and the chromatography paper, we can separate the component and they get separated at different heights. This method we call chromatography. The next one is now, suppose now as I discussed now, if we have a volatile, non-volatile component involved, find this in a patient. Now suppose I have been given a mixture of solid solution. And as I know, it's a mixture of salt and water. If I need only salt, I can go for evaporation. But if I want water also, then evaporation will not help me. Then I have to go for another method which we call distillation. Now distillation, actually distillation involves two processes. First is the heating a liquid to change into vapor, which is followed by condensation of the vapor to give that liquid back. So it's evaporation followed by condensation separately, in a separate process. So this any solution, be it a solution of solid in liquid or be it a solution of two miscible liquid, that can easily be separated by distillation. So this is a distillation flask, a round bottom flask which is having a side tube. This flask we call distillation flask. Here I can take salt solution. And this is a condenser. Condenser is a long glass tube which is surrounded by a glass circuit. And here you can see that in glass circuit, cold air, cold water is being circulated to the inlet. It goes in and from this it goes out. So vapor will always be surrounded by cold water, so they will be condensing. So this part, this apparatus is called condenser. As a vapor after condensation will change into liquid, so liquid can be collected in a beaker. Any receiver, it could be conical glass or a beaker. So this is the arrangement to carry out condensing, this distillation solution, right? So salt solution, if I take here in a distillation glass, then only water will change into vapor, will condense here and will be separated and give it collected in the beaker. Salt I can obtain here in the distillation process. Not only this, as I said, simple distillation can be done for any type of solution. So if it is a solution of two miscible liquids means a liquid which mix with each other, then these mixers can again be separated by distillation. Let it be, here again depending on, actually the principle involved in distillation is, if we take two components and they have different boiling points, if difference in the boiling point is more than 25 Kelvin, then we do simple distillation. And if difference in the boiling point is very close, it's less than 25 Kelvin, then we use fractional distillation. Right. I suppose I have missing a liquid. Let this be a mixture of acetone and water. Acetone has 56 degree centigrade the boiling point, water has 100 degree centigrade. Right? If such a miscible solution of miscible liquid I have, then I can separate them by simple distillation. Here I will be taking the mixer. As the temperature reaches 56 degree centigrade, acetone will change into vapor and the vapor of acetone will pass through the condenser and will condense to give acetone here and water will be left in the distillation. But if I have a mixture of alcohol and water, then it will be difficult to separate the components by simple distillation because alcohol has boiling point around 78 degree centigrade, whereas water has around 100 degree centigrade. So what happens if I'll be using simple distillation? As the temperature reaches 78 degree centigrade, then alcohol will change into vapor, but at this temperature some water will also change into vapor. So after condensation, the liquid which will be collected in the receiver will not be pure alcohol. So it could be a mixer. For this, we use a fractional distillation if the boiling points of the components are close and difference is less than 25 Kelvin. Then with this, we just distillation glass, we attach a fractionating column. Fractionating column, here it has small beads of glass. So when the vapor of alcohol and water will be rising, then as the surface, more surface area is provided by the beads, then the vapor will cool down. And then some vapor, which is as the liquid cools down, it gets back into the glass, it will be condensing some more vapor. So only the vapor of alcohol will be passing through the condenser and will condense to get alcohol here and water will be left here. So in this case, we use fractional distillation. Now this is one application of fractional, a number of applications of fractional distillation. Okay, then the fractional distillation of petroleum is carried out to separate the important constituents like petroleum gas, kerosene, diesel, then it could be lubricating oil. So that is fractional distillation. Now separation of component of air can also be done with the fractional distillation. Let us see how is it carried out. First of all, air is changed. Air is a homogeneous mixture of a number of gases. We liquefy air, and we know that a gas can be liquefied by increasing pressure and decreasing temperature. So it is compressed and to high pressure, and temperature is decreased. Then it changes into liquid. But as we know that mainly the components which are there, nitrogen is the main ingredient, is the main constituent, sorry. It's nitrogen is the main constituent, that is oxygen and then carbon, except in the premium gas. So what happens when we apply pressure and we decrease temperature, then carbon dioxide simply separates out as the solid ice. As a dry ice, solid carbon dioxide. Right. Now mainly this liquid air will be consisting of the three components. It will be having liquid nitrogen, liquid oxygen, and we will be having liquid inert gas, mainly carbon air. Now we allow this liquid air to rise in a fractionating column. Now here you can see the boiling points of oxygen, liquid oxygen is minus 183, argon is 186 and that is 190, minus 186 is 90. Then this liquid oxygen, liquid air is allowed to just rise in a fractionating column. Now at a very low temperature, we could change air into liquid air, and all these components were in the liquid state at a very low temperature. So when it is allowed to rise, when it is introduced into a fractionating column, what happens? The temperature increases, right? So as the temperature increases, so first nitrogen, which is having its boiling point minus 196, that will change into gas, and as gas from an outlet which is at the top, it is taken. And now mainly the oxygen that move in the liquid state is left in that fractionating column, which can simply be filled in the cylinders and can be used. So this way the main constituents of air, that is liquid or nitrogen and oxygen, can be separated by fractional distillation. Another one more method is air, which is actually used for purification. It's a purification, or we can say that separation of impurities, soluble impurities, which are soluble as well as insoluble impurities which are present in crystals. This method we call crystallization. So here in crystallization, whenever we want to prepare the pure crystals of any solid substance, first of all we prepare a hot and saturated solution of that solution, that solid in water, and then we allow it to cool. You know, on cooling the solubility of solid decreases in water. So as a result, some solid in this solution will become insoluble because its solubility has decreased as the temperature goes down. Then those, that insoluble solid, that separates out in the form of crystals. Actually, before just allowing it to cool, we just filter it out to remove all the insoluble impurities. Now when crystals, the insoluble solid separates as a crystal, all the soluble impurities also are left in the solution. Only will be obtaining the crystals of the pure substance only, which will be free from soluble as well as the insoluble impurities. This process is better than evaporation. In evaporation, suppose I want to obtain sugar from sugar solution, that cannot be obtained by evaporation because sugar will decompose. If it will be heated for long, then sugar will decompose. But easily we can obtain the sugar crystals by crystallization. So this is a better method. These are some techniques of separation of compounds, of the mixes. So this basically depends on the what all are the properties of the components of the substances which have been mixed together. So based on that, their properties, we can find the technique of separation. Thank you. That's all for this chapter.